to you. Good morning from the great city of Chicago, albeit a city that has trouble with systemic violence, drug issues, and gang issues. And for the next hour, we are here, John and Ray, with former Superintendent Garry McCarthy, who has been in and out of the news since he was cashiered in December of 2015 after about 4.5 years as our police superintendent. Actually, on his way over here, Ray, on his way to this program from Channel 9 when he got the call from Rahm Emanuel, hey, I support you 100%, but can you drop by the fifth floor for a brief meeting? And then we got the call. Garry McCarthy is going to be slightly delayed this morning. Mr. Superintendent, or former superintendent, welcome to WLS.
Well, thank you. It took me, I guess, 15 months to get here, but I'm here.
I'm glad you're... Well, we've had you on the phone a number of times.
Look, that's right.
Earlier this week, you said on this program you want performance-based government instead of politically-based government. Can you elaborate on that? How can politics be eliminated at all? Do you want to weaken mayoral powers? The council hired strong city managers. Should the mayors be stripped of the power of appointing or nominating police superintendents?
So, you know, my experience goes back, obviously, a long time to New York. I became the deputy commissioner of operations in the NYPD in, actually on Y2K, January 1st, 2000, I took over. And New York City, under Mayor Giuliani at the time, had started performance-based government. Looking at different metrics for whatever, sanitation, transportation. On the way over here, actually, this morning, I thought that somebody needs to look at the number of CTA buses that are blocking intersections.
Yeah, like herds of buffalo.
Yeah, and there's like five of them at a time. That kind of smacks of mismanagement to me. And I could be mistaken. I don't know anything about CTA. But in just looking at it, I see that there's an issue there. And there's probably metrics that need to be measured as far as buses being on time, what routes they're taking, what the ridership is, and so on. And, you know, the CompSat process that was started in the NYPD back in the day is what I'm accustomed to. That's how I've run the Chicago Police Department. That's how I ran the Newark Police Department. And that's how we ran the New York City Police Department, which, you know, is still going in the right direction.
But the mayor's, you know, efforts to find the next police superintendent after you were cashiered, they gave him three recommendations. He dismissed all three of those. Eddie Johnson is now the superintendent. Do you think it's inherently a flawed process?
Well, they didn't follow the process. By municipal law, the police board selects three candidates. And the mayor gets to choose from those three candidates if he likes or doesn't like them. He either accepts one or he throws out the search and he has them do it again. And in this case, they changed the law for one day. Hmm. That's municipal law. And by the way, I was mistaken the other day. I was corrected and I actually owe an apology to Pat Thompson, the alderman down in Bridgeport, who did actually vote against skirting it. I don't believe that anybody else did, but I'm apologizing to Pat. On the air. But the point is this, and this is what I tried to say the other day, and maybe I didn't get it out properly. You can't have legitimate policing, which is what everybody wants. Everybody talks about police legitimacy. If you're working in a system that doesn't stick to process, that process is in place to prevent things like what happened with the Shachtman decree that we were under for God knows how long. I don't even know. But I was happy to be a part of getting the city out of it, but I'm not sure that we've learned our lesson from that.
Have a town hall underway here with John Howell and Ray Stevens of former Police Superintendent Garry McCarthy.
How closely did you work with Eddie Johnson in the department, and what do you think of him both as a person and as a cop?
I have enormous respect for Eddie. When I first got here, Eddie was the commander of the 6th District. He was one of the first individuals I met. Because what I did was I got into the car with my drivers and I said, okay, show me the busy districts. And the first place I went was 6, and that's where Eddie was. And looking at the way that he ran the district, in speaking to the folks who worked for him, I saw real potential in his leadership. Eddie, I believe, was my first promotion, actually Al Weisinger, my selection to be the first deputy superintendent. But Eddie was my first promotion to deputy chief, and he was actually my last promotion to chief of patrol as I was Let's call it walking out the door. Walking out the door.
I guess my follow-up question to that would be, do you believe he's qualified to be a superintendent here in town?
I do. But like I said the other day or on a different show, the political landscape has completely changed in policing. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I think one of the things that I do wrong, I haven't done everything right, is that I am a little bit stubborn. I'm Irish, right? I'm also a Taurus and a linebacker, so everything is right in front of you, and I lead with my chin. And honestly, I would have been handling what's happening here a lot differently. In that the DOJ report was a complete hack job, and it was done politically. Some of the things that are happening internally, the disciplinary process, the witch hunt that's been underway since my termination, it just has me outraged. I said on the show, I believe, the other day, that the chief of detectives, one of the highest, most respected jobs in any police department in the country, was forced to retire for using his personal email to review detective documents.
Optics are everything now, and that's a problem. I want to talk about data-driven policing here.
Okay.
Yeah. And can it ever be modified enough to quell the charges that it's inherently racist? To think about that for a minute, and we'll come back and get your answer to that. We're here with a former superintendent.
I've already thought about it, John, but I'll do some more.
Garry McCarthy is here. He's here until 10 o'clock.
WLS AM 890 News Talk Evolved.
Our friend Garry McCarthy is here, former superintendent, came out of New York via Newark. Rahm Emanuel brought him to town May of 2011, cashiered him just before Christmas 2015, spent about 4.5 years. We're here for the entire hour, kind of a Friday town hall meeting on crime, drugs, gangs, politics, modern policing. I want to get to data-driven policing in a second, but first, you mentioned you were Irish, leading with your chin.
Right.
Race permeates everything. I'll be delicate in this question, but can a non-minority superintendent still be politically viable in a city that is now majority-minority, any city? And does race always stack the deck of public perception as far as who is going to lead big city departments?
You know, that's a great question. And the way that I like to answer that is I like to point out the fact that when the NYPD had an issue in the 7-0 precinct in Brooklyn, when some officers actually sodomized a man named Abner Louimer in a bathroom, they didn't send an African-American leader to that district. First, they sent a guy who I believe he's definitely Hispanic, and after him, I went there. So, you know, the issue of race does permeate everything. But we're not having honest conversations about it, you know. And the honest conversation, I mean, this goes right into the data-driven policing. It's all wrapped around each other. And my issue is that we haven't in this country really recognized how we got to where we are. Everybody knows the story about segregation and red lines here in Chicago. Everybody knows the story of slavery, black codes, segregation, Jim Crow. And the fact that it was the white police officer who was enforcing those racist laws. Those are inherently racist laws that were being enforced by the white police officer.
History's history, that's indisputable.
Now, the point is, that narrative of distrust that people talk about, reestablishing trust, we haven't had that trust for 400 years, so let's stop the nonsense. Let's have this conversation. Let's talk about how we got to where we are.
Have politicians in big cities like our own, have they created this sort of environment by pandering to special interests and becoming very, very noisy but small, squeaky wheels?
I believe that elected officials have really had a lot to do with the fact that the race issue has come off the rails in the last 8 to 10 years. And, you know, you would think after having an African-American president, we'd be in a better place, but it seems like we went backwards. The point is, By consistently falling back on race instead of looking at the socioeconomic issues that exist in this country, like poverty, lack of education, a breakup of the family unit, lead in the water, lack of health care, lack of mental health care, narcotics, crime that overrun the disenfranchised communities and the anger that exists in those communities as a result of failed government.
By pointing out those communities, you're labeled a racist.
Well, you get labeled a racist sometimes just for saying good morning in the wrong fashion. I've noticed this.
But it would seem to me that you bring up a good point. You know, we've been doing the same thing over and over and over again, and it doesn't work.
Right.
You're sending officers out to communities where people seemingly have nothing to lose. How do you go in there and try to change that culture unless you can change the way that they are providing for themselves? And that starts with jobs and everything else that you just spoke of.
Exactly right. And there's this concept, which right now is escaping me for some reason, that I know a lot about, collective efficacy. Government cannot fix those problems, but what we can do is provide the opportunity for those communities to succeed. We can't make people do things, right? But we can provide the opportunities for them. And I'll give you a simple example. You know, everybody wants to know what we could do as far as education and jobs and the disenfranchised communities. What if we were to, it dawned on me that we don't have the schools that teach trades here anymore. I don't think so.
Even if they teach trades in the schools, there's not manufacturing jobs in this community if the kids get that.
I'm glad you brought that up.
Yeah, so that one without the other is useless.
Exactly right. So why aren't there tax breaks for businesses that work in those communities that would be feeders for the schools that are producing those kids with those skills?
Jack Kemp. That's what Jack Kemp used to propose.
He's a smart guy.
Those enterprise zones. We're here with Garry McCarthy, our former superintendent. You were on our show a couple days ago. You said some comments that were picked up in the papers and TV stations and so on and so forth. Our own Bill Cameron got to the mayor and said, Mr. Mayor, would you like to comment on Garry McCarthy's comments regarding the political nature of big city policing? And the mayor just responded, no. Why doesn't the mayor respond to your comments nowadays?
Well, look, I don't want to be seen as being specifically critical of the mayor because people will say I have an axe to grind. I can tell you this. I am disappointed in the way that this entire scenario played out. I'm disappointed at the fact that, you know, I haven't heard from the guy in 15 months. He didn't check in to see if I was okay. He didn't say congratulations on the birth of your son. That's not the way it's supposed to work. If he needed to make a decision that he thought was a good decision, doesn't mean a relationship is over, but apparently it is. So
you went out with a lot of grace, though. It's not like you burned the bridge. When you left, you left.
I know. And I kind of think the same thing. So I'm not going to be specifically critical of the mayor, but here's what I will say. You've seen this over and over again. I have never done a press conference and not answered just about every question that gets asked of me. So look,
that's why you can never be mayor.
He does. That's
answered too many questions.
I guess so.
I guess my question to you, outside of, you know, okay, you were cashiered 15 months ago, but it seems to me like you have a tremendous amount of care for what's going on in the city that you came to. And I know you're a New York guy. What is it that makes you care so much about this town?
So I'm not leaving. I got remarried 2 years ago. I got very fortunate, and I met Kristen. I now have a 6-month-old son. This town has welcomed me with open arms. You know, the only people I didn't get along with were some elected officials, and I'm not even referring to the mayor, right? Because I wanted to do things in a different fashion. You had aldermen who wanted to pick their district commanders, and I told them no. When you're accountable for their performance, then you can pick them.
But we've always done it this way.
That's what I always hear.
All right, since we're talking about politicians, who was the best and worst to work for? Think about this. We'll come back and get your answer. Rahm, Cory Booker, Rudy Giuliani, Michael Bloomberg. We're here with Garry McCarthy. He's going to be with us. So I asked you to think about that. You've worked for all these guys. Best and worst, put them in order if you want. Who's the most natural political animal? Who was the best to work for? Who was the most hands-off in general? In reverse order, Rahm Emanuel, Cory Booker, Michael Bloomberg, Rudy Giuliani.
Great question. So I'm not going to lie. Rudy Giuliani appointed me as deputy commissioner. I was with him on 9/11. When I tell a story, I point out that I created the command post. If you ever heard Rudy tell a story that we got trapped in. And I also tell a story that I also got us out, so therefore I kept my job after 9/11. Yeah. And there was some political machinations near the end of Rudy's administration, and quite frankly, he intervened and made sure that I was okay.
So how about Mr. Emanuel?
I have a great affinity for him. I think
Up against Rudy Giuliani, how do you put Rahm's talents versus Rudy's?
Well, I think he's much more political. You asked who's the most political animal. I would say that Rahm Emanuel is. He functions on that level. He's looking at the political insights to all these things. Rudy was the type of person and is the type of person who would, you know, what you see is what you get. He draws line in the sand, and that would be it. If people didn't like it, it was too bad.
If Giuliani saved you back then, would Rahm have saved you had he been in the same position?
Based on the experience, I would probably say no.
I wanted to ask you here about this ACLU, this talk about the ISR, the investigative stop reports that our police officers have to fill out. Much has been made about this, but you contend if you don't want it, get rid of it because state law will still be in effect.
Yeah, I was a little bit taken aback when Zach Farden, the former U.S. attorney, pointed to the ACLU agreement. Him being the United States attorney, I would expect that he would know that state law supersedes that agreement. The language in that agreement was taken straight out of Senate Bill 1204. So rip up the agreement, and you still have to record the same data. And the way that happened was that we were fighting with the ACLU, didn't want to put it into it, so they went around us, went to Springfield, got some politicians to put it into a bill, and therefore it's state law.
Garry McCarthy is here, our former superintendent. Before we get to some more questions from our group here, it's our Friday Town Hall. Here's an unnamed police officer who would like to speak to you. Go ahead, sir. Welcome to the program.
Morning. Morning, Superintendent. How are you?
Morning.
I'll tell you, you got a raw deal. I think you did a good job. I think the moment you got here, you had a lot of people who, you know, didn't like the fact that you were from the outside. And I think a lot of them put roadblocks up. When I say we as a group of police officers, that we like to talk politics and, you know, superintendent stuff. And we talk about it sometimes when we're working overtime in our VRI spots and say, hey, it's nice that you did not, you know, succumb to the ministers and the reverends and what have you and the aldermen who wanted to put their own people in. That's something that people, we've hated as police officers for the 28 years that I've been doing law enforcement here, is that they, you know, have the aldermen make their people, and really there's no accountability to the boss himself.
Would you vote you vote for Garry if you ran for mayor?
I would.
Well, I guess my question is,
I really like this guy. Can I promote him?
You're promoted. Call back anytime. We appreciate it. Stay safe.
Yeah, we just keep coming back to people just trying to be honest. I mean, we've become too politically correct in a world, in a society, in a city that needs brutal honesty. We know where the crime comes from, yet and you've talked about this from time to time in Inglewood, you want to arrest, 33%
whites.
Yeah, which we know is just...
The population demographic does not reflect the crime demographic. And we go where, when, and look for who is committing crime. Well, and people call that systemic racism.
So when we see the mother on TV crying that her kid was shot, and we see it every night, how long is it going to take before somebody says, well, this is the way, if we keep doing things the same way, how is it ever going to get fixed? It's insanity.
Yeah, I've been saying that since I got here, which now is going on 6 years ago. We need to change the methods that we use if we want to address these issues. And that's why I'm saying performance-based government. That's what I'm accustomed to. That's what I came up on. And it's something that's sorely lacking here that New York and L.A. are doing, which has kept them going in the right direction.
The truth can be very troubling sometimes to people. We're here with Garry McCarthy, our friend from downstairs. Mary Ann Ahern is here from NBC5. Thanks for coming up.
Well, thanks a lot. And first of all, thank you, Superintendent, because when we last saw each other, might not have been on such good terms because you were in such a difficult spot. And I think the media you had perceived as against you and for Rahm. Do you still see it that way?
I think it's forgotten. We've moved on. The communication strategy of look at the squirrel has it that making an announcement every day moves us away from the issues that we need to address.
So you have said you want to do something positive. Does something positive, and I know you've kind of skirted this, but, you know, being the guy that questions the mayor is probably healthy at a time when not many are. Where's the end game? I mean, if you don't run for mayor, where do you go?
You know, I'm in a position, Mary Ann, I'm going to be 58 years old. I have a 6-month-old son, dedicated my life to public service, which means that I don't have much in the bank. So, you know, I have to focus on my business, expanding my business, and trying to provide security for my family. That's what I'm doing. Staying relevant helps that business. So quite frankly, that's a good thing. But the bottom line to me is, you know, I have an expertise. I jokingly say that, you know, I'm not the smartest guy in the room, but if you put me in a room with 100 people who want to talk about law enforcement, I might be in the top 10, right? That's my forte. That's what I'm really good at. I'm still being called on to go and speak about law enforcement. And, you know, I see it so clearly. One of the things that I think I do right is I can unpack an issue, come up with a solution, and put it back together. That's how I got the position of being in charge of crime control strategy in New York in the first place. And I see the issues here. I see solutions. And we're not going down those roads. We've reversed. L.A. and New York did not reverse course when they had problems. New York had Eric Garner, right? The quote-unquote illegal chokehold death. They didn't just stop doing what they were doing. And here in Chicago, unfortunately, we've reversed course.
Why'd you get dragged into the divorce of Jesse Jackson Jr. out of curiosity?
When you find out, please tell me. Because
so
I
glad
just
you asked
do
it
not
me.
Know.
Thank you.
Out of all
I
the things
do
you don't
know.
Need.
That's something I picked that up the morning I picked up the paper. Like, what is going on here? How's Garry McCarthy involved in this ugly divorce?
I got to tell you the best part of that story.
Distraction?
When this came up, maybe. When this came up, I was walking out of actually another news station when a reporter brought it up to my attention. So when I got in the car, I immediately called Kristen, called my wife, and I said, before you put on the TV, let me tell you what's going on. And when I told her, she just started laughing. And I said, as long as you're okay, I'm okay. Well, it's public folly. Let it go.
Sandy Jackson was an alderman, and you knew all of the aldermen as the top cop of Chicago. But were you friends with her? Did you have any kind of relationship with her at all?
We had a friendly relationship, but entirely professional, just like I have with Ed Burke, Jim Balser, Willie Cochran, I had a great relationship with. So, you have to have those relationships, and it was nothing unusual.
How can police rank and file support their partners, develop trust and a safe working relationship over years without some form of, and I'm being sensitive here, a code of silence? In other words, in this very litigious society, everybody has a camera. We're going to have dash cams. We're going to have body cams. Gun cams, and you have to protect your partner's back and still remain legally viable, I suppose, but is that inherently corrosive to cops working together and trusting each other?
Well, there has to be a culture within policing just not non-tolerance of corruption. You know,
Is there a tipping point for that? If a guy goes in and gets a free cup of coffee, do I have to report my partner? Where's the tripwire for I have to go to internal affairs about this?
So just to answer that question, I can't tell you how many times in my lifetime people have given me free coffee or offered me a free meal. And what I do is I always make sure that I leave a tip that covers my meal, and I try not to go back to those locations. It doesn't mean that I'm going to arrest the person or if my partner were in the same position. So that's a slippery slope, quite frankly. The line to me really comes with some sort of theft. That's where it really comes. Now, that's only about corruption. Now, if we're talking about excessive force, many times I've stopped officers from using excessive force, and other times I've had officers actually intervene when I had my adrenaline going after chasing somebody for five blocks and there were shots fired at me.
Eddie Johnson just elaborated on an incident that he had as an officer where they said, why, if somebody's running away, would you ever shoot at them as they're running away? He goes, you don't understand. I was shot at by somebody running away. I returned fire.
Yeah,
in other words, you could hit a guy in the back and still be well within your rights, the protocol of the police department.
Right after I got here, there was a young officer named Jim Bansley who was shot by a guy he was chasing. And it was real simple. When you're pumping your arm, you just push your arm back and pull the trigger. Mm-hmm. We have video of it. As a matter of fact, Anita Alvarez showed that video when she chose not to indict a police officer for shooting somebody in the back. And this guy was actually shot in the armpit. So think about it. That meant that his hand was up. You can't get hit in the armpit if your arm is down. You get hit in the shoulder.
Yeah.
So, people don't understand that. Believe it or not, we actually... I think it was the FBI, worked with corrections agencies across the country and actually saw inmates training each other in these techniques and how to escape police handcuffs and things like that.
Nice. Yeah, colleges.
I want to talk to you coming up about a bill that was passed yesterday in Springfield about repeat gun offenders. I think it's important, and I think it's something that can protect, you know, the police officers of Chicago.
Garry McCarthy is here for a few remaining moments. Another round of questions coming up here. First, a traffic update at 9:45. Here's Jen.
A few things going on the area roadways. Eisenhower.
Ray, you mentioned before the break there's some legislation that passed in Springfield.
Yeah, yesterday in Springfield, Superintendent, the state finally passed a bill to toughen sentences for repeat gun offenders. And black lawmakers from Chicago have historically been against the bill because they feel that it is unfair to black men. What would you say to those lawmakers in a city where the other day there was a case where a kid goes to get retribution for his father being shot? His father gets shot. He goes. He kills four people. His dad was out of prison after being arrested 56 times, two of those convictions for murders. I mean, we know where the crime's coming from. How do you fix it?
So I think, and I've said this to those legislators before, you know, would you rather see them interned or incarcerated? Because that's the path that individuals who carry illegal guns, who are gangbangers, are going down. The problem with the legislation that I see is that the judges may not have to apply those stricter laws. In other words, they can, you know, when I got here, there was supposed to be a minimum sentence for gun possession, and they were getting probation and boot camp. You know, in the first quarter of 2015, we tracked our gun arrests. We arrested 688 people 692 times. And you say, well, how can that be? That's because we arrested four people twice in a 90-day period. 75% of those individuals were back on the street on April 1st, the first day of the second quarter, including three out of the four who were arrested twice with illegal guns, twice in 90 days. If those are not public safety hazards, getting arrested twice in 90 days with illegal guns, I don't know who is.
That's a pretty good definition. Garry McCarthy is here. Marianne Ahern is here from NBC5.
And there's so many questions, but okay, so if you're not a candidate, do you see yourself as someone who will support someone else? Will you be the guy that sort of is out there with the constant questions of where is the mayor going and why should he get a third term?
You know, Marianne, and I'm not skirting this question. I just don't know. I'm not planning what's going to happen in the next few months. I'm just trying to have an impact in some fashion by talking about what's going on. And if that means getting involved in politics, then maybe I'm going to do it. I could tell you this. The first person I have to convince is Kristen, because she would much rather I have a low profile and people leave us alone.
And a better paycheck.
And a better paycheck, too.
Yeah. John Dempsey?
Garry, the thing that led to your downfall was, of course, the Laquan McDonald video. And I remember Mayor Emanuel was singing your praises in the days and weeks, even in the hours before the release of that video. Then you're abruptly fired while you're doing the TV rounds one morning to talk about the previous month's crime rates. How could that issue have been handled differently? The whole video and the release of the video, I know it was released under court order, but could anything have happened to have that situation have had a better outcome?
Yeah. What could have happened is in 2012, when I wanted to reform our disciplinary system, we would have done it. The problem that I see right now, and a quick analogy, you know, 343 firefighters got killed on 9/11. The reason why they lost the command staff of the fire department in the city of New York is that the protocol for high-rise fires had it that they set up their command center in the basement of those buildings. You know what the protocol is today? Exactly the same. So we don't really learn from our mistakes. And in this case, you know, people want outside investigations into police uses of force. We have IPRA, right? That's what we had at the time. People want civilian oversight to police departments. Well, we've got the police board. And we had the police board then. I was not the final determiner of discipline. I could only make a recommendation for suspensions of 30 days or more or termination cases. People wanted federal investigations into police uses of force. In the Laquan McDonald case, we had that also because IPRA went right to the FBI, went right to the U.S. attorney. So all the components that everybody wants to see, that everybody is clamoring for, exist here in Chicago. Those conditions still exist. So if Eddie Johnson has one of those incidents today, the only step that he could take by Illinois state law is put that officer on paid desk duty, which is exactly what I did. So accountability without authority equals failure.
What should you have been able to do?
I should have been able to suspend the officer without pay, put him into a no-pay status, but I couldn't do that until he was indicted.
And that means changing the contract.
That means changing the law, because I believe I was told that it was Illinois state law, not even the contract, that was preventing that. But the point being, the system is producing what it's designed to produce. I was not in charge of my disciplinary system, like I said, but I was accountable for the behavior of every officer.
That's a problem.
Doesn't make sense.
We have about a minute left. We thank you for your time. Is there anything you want to say to the city and the politicians listening? You have the final word.
Well, everybody loves Chicago. I've never met a city, a group of people who live in a city like Chicago that just absolutely love their city. The problems that exist here, we all know what they are. The problem is we're not acknowledging the solutions. And we haven't acknowledged that socio and economic problem. We're in a position right now where it's the police are the problem. And the police are not the problem. There's a social economic issue that exists in this country that's really front line here in Chicago that needs to be acknowledged before it can be addressed. We're taking the wrong medicine for what ails us if we keep going down this path of the police are the problem, It's akin to getting a shoulder surgery for a back problem, because in 2 years, your back is still going to be hurting you. We're taking the wrong medicine for what ails us.
Thank you for your time this morning.
Always a pleasure.
Much appreciated. Garry McCarthy here at WLS.